Microphone working? Can you hear me? Well, thanks very much for coming here tonight, and thanks very much for the invitation. And not least, thank you so much for funding me, which is highly important. I'm having a great year here. I came in September. I'm still here, and I'd like to continue until May or so. So I'm really having a very nice, fruitful, and productive time. And I know I'm giving another talk on the 8th of March, but after my talk tonight, maybe you will have second thoughts, and maybe that talk will not happen. We will see, okay? Today, as the title says, I would like to talk about the Trump administration and what is happening, not so much in this country, but really what's happening to the world. It's about Trump and internet, I will say. I hope I'm not going to have that happen to you. But to talk with Donald Trump, it will be an amazing talk. Normally, when we talk about foreign policy and international relations, what statesmen, what politicians, like Obama, like Angela Merkel, like George W. Bush, and whoever was there in the past, what they all have to do is to have a balance. They really have to juggle a lot of balls at the same time. There's a famous book about Franklin Roosevelt called The Juggler, indicating he had so many balls in the air, both domestically but also foreign policy ones, that it really required a very complex worldview and quite a lot of skill and talent to do that and to be successful. That is not what we see now, I would say. What we see now is more about nationalism and about also about bilateralism. So far, Donald Trump and his administration seem not to engage in international organizations and multilateralism, but it's all about bilateralism. So the question, of course, comes up whether that really is a policy addressing here. Are we talking about a policy going back to the 1950s or even before that? Mikhail Gorbachev only yesterday came out with a statement saying it looks as if the world is preparing for war. That is, of course, very dramatic, and I wouldn't immediately subscribe to that, but the world definitely has become more dangerous than it only was a few years ago. What I want to do today is the following. I would like to talk, with my foreign policy impressions about the new administration, talk about the image factor and the people involved, and then cover Europe, Russia, Middle East, China, and also then, at the end, we all want to give them some good advice how to better direct the foreign policy. And of course, that all will take me 2 to 3 hours, and I hope you'll more some time. Right, let's start with my first foreign policy impression of the new administration. What you could read in the media was that Donald Trump is an isolationist, a neo-isolationist. I think that is not correct. This administration wants to engage with the world, but in a very bossy way. Not in a multilateral way, but in an America first way. But it certainly isn't an isolationist administration. When he talks about fighting ISA, when he gave this talk at the CIA saying he wants to take oil again, when he talks even about cooperating with Russia and Syria, or when he talks even about NATO, it does not mean he wants to go back to 1920s isolationism. So Trump is no Harding. He's no Tony Blair, like a liberal interventionist. He's also not a neoconservative idealist, like Cheney was. And certainly, he is not a realist, like Burnett, Nixon, and Kissinger. His foreign policy, I believe, consists of American primacy and dominance. And that is a policy which is embedded not in international organizations, not in networks, not constrained by alliances and organizations, but it really is America policy first. America comes first. And we mentioned that today again when we met with the British Prime Minister May. And we also see foreign policy as a zero-sum game. We have to win again, he keeps saying all the time. We haven't won anything at all in the last few years, he keeps saying, but now it's time that America wins again. So it's really it's like a football match. You either win or lose. And the draw is really a loss to him. It really is almost as simple as that. And he does not believe in the current world order. He believes that that is an order which is not good for the United States. The United States is not winning, but it is costly for the United States. But he is heading a protectionist see. He's not isolationist, but protectionist. And when you look at that little table here, you can see that with many important countries, at least in a trade sense, the United States is not is running a deficit, is running a trade deficit. Now, with Mexico, as you know, it's getting rather upset with Mexico at the moment, is a $60-70 billion trade deficit. And the same applies hugely with China, almost more than $300 billion, and with the European Union as well, and even with Canada to a lesser extent. Of course, it has not occurred to him why that is the case. Maybe a little bit of self-criticism would be appropriate. But of course, particularly in the case of China, I think we all agree, though perhaps not to the same extent as John argued, we all agree that there is perhaps not a level playing field, that there is some policy which could be rectified where the United States, where the Western world is really being exploited. And I would, to some extent, I would go ahead and along with that, and I will come back to that later. But when you think of Canada, the Canadians, are they pushing and bullying the United States into a bad trade deal? Is that really correct? I wonder. One also should ask, what about the competitiveness of this country? Maybe in the 50s and 60s and 70s, American companies were simply better than they are today. So what we need to have is not a bullying foreign policy or foreign policy which complains that, that the country is being exploited and abused by foreigners, but perhaps we need not only a new infrastructure program, but also a new educational program, like we had in the late 1950s when the Sputnik stopped the nation, when the Soviet Union suddenly put a man into space and the United States was severely shocked. Said, God, why didn't we do that first? And instead of complaining about unfair rules and the Soviet Union exploiting the United States, they put a lot of new money into the sciences, into education. And of course, the result was that 10 years later, the first man on the moon was an American and not a Soviet cosmonaut. And that really was the effect of the Sputnik shock and the investment in education and the sciences after that Sputnik shock. And I think something like that would be the right policy today, rather than just about complaining about the unfairness of the world and other countries not playing fairly with the United States. Well, the image sector abroad has been disastrous, to put it mildly. Abroad, and I've just come back over Christmas, I was briefly in Europe and I was in China and in Asia, and the image even then, and it has become worse, of course, in the last few weeks, it was very poor. Trump is seen as someone who is irrational, who is impulsive, who is insecure, and also perhaps overwhelmed with responsibility and simply not up to the job. And when you look at that long list that's given you here, you know, that talk about alternative facts, that dispute about immigration crowd numbers, those are broad claims which seem to be totally illusionary. Here, reality seems to have totally gone out of the picture. And also the use of Twitter. You know, in Asia and in China, how could no one understand how a leading statesman can use Twitter to make a statement? 140 characters at 4 o'clock in the morning in an impulsive way. Would the Philippines do that? Would Angela Merkel do that? Would the Japanese Prime Minister do that? Probably not. Why does the American President do that? That really is a very bad image factor. And I think that war with the media, which is part of it, the thin-skinned nature of the new president, that really goes down very badly. And that is, of course, the picture everyone wants. And it is, you know, if you are in reality and not trying to make reality disappear, you would simply admit, well, sure, there were a few million or a few hundred thousand more when my predecessor got inaugurated. Big deal. Why would anyone get so upset about it if you were secure and were you, you know, were really facing the new responsibilities? Regarding foreign policy, the image factor probably is even more serious. You know, what is seen as Trump's war with the intelligence community, the own intelligence community, I think damages the picture of American foreign policy. Then also picking a fight with China immediately. Remember that phone call with the Taiwanese president. I wonder whether that was necessary. Then his Trump inauguration speech didn't go down too well. Then, of course, recently the wall, and Mexico will pay for it through the 20% tariff. And also what was recently said about CIA, the revival of CIA prisons, and that torture may actually be a good idea. All that, I think, has damaged American image abroad. And American image abroad, the market strength is actually quite positive, until recently, I would say. When there is a lot of talk about anti-Americanism, then that is true to some extent. There are, you know, in Europe, in Germany, in France, there is definitely a margin of society, a fringe of society, both on the left and the right, who would be anti-American. But mainstream European society, and particularly also mainstream Asian society, is actually quite positive towards the United States. And what we see now has made the image of America plummet disastrously. I don't think that is irreversible. For example, today, when I watched the press conference, Trump goes to the British Prime Minister, he came across pretty decent, pretty statesmanlike, quite calm. He said a few things which were may not have been all that great, like when he said that he believed waterboarding was a good idea, but he would defer to his new Secretary of Defense whether or not to implement it again. So, you know, he basically explained that he believed in a technique which is unlawful, which, you know, is not really a good idea for a president to say on public television. But apart from that, you know, the performance today at the press conference was much better than the performance we saw yesterday or the day before. So I believe, on the whole, maybe there's hope yet. Now, there might be a steep learning curve, and I think there has to be, it will be a steep learning curve, but I don't think that it will be the kind of impulsive reactions of the last few days. I think Trump may take a lot longer than his predecessor, but I'm not entirely pessimistic that he will not also get there. It will only take him a little longer. Then we have the people factor, and here abroad, you know, the foreign countries are quite worried about the close advisors. The big three are the ones I listed first. They all have no foreign policy experience. They're all ideologues in a Trumpian sense. And the other three, maybe a little bit less important, are also, you know, very ideological, like Kellyanne Conway, we know her from the alternative expectation on television, Sean Spicer, who yelled at the press during his first performance, all these, and Peter Navarro is, of course, a guy who is very anti-China, who's written a book, two books, very anti-China, who basically says the Chinese exploit the United States totally unfairly. And the second book is available for free on YouTube. It has been put into a documentary on YouTube. And I'm deeply convinced that Trump saw that video on YouTube. And that made him convinced that Peter Navarro would be the right guy for him. The other people are slightly better, I think, particularly Rex Tillerson and General Mattis. These are the common sense people in the administration, as far as I can see. And Tillerson probably will get confirmed next week. And these two could probably be in any conservative government, and not just in a fairly unusual Trump government. The first one, Michael Flynn, also a general, is the new national security advisor, as we know, and he is much more ideological and much more unpredictable than Tillerson and Mattis. And I think he needs to be watched, and we can only hope that Trump's relationship with Flynn will not develop too close, that he will really rely more on Mattis and Tillerson than on Flynn. And I was recently in Beijing, I talked to some Western diplomats as well, and one military attaché told me that he served with Michael Flynn as a soldier in Afghanistan, and he said the guy was off the wall. He really said he's irresponsible, and that was when he was a soldier. So that didn't, you other two I've made highlighted in red are also very anti-Chinese, very ideological in their belief that foreign countries are damaging the United States. The others, I think, are much more middle of the road than this one hopes yet. Let me talk briefly. Let me talk about the current global challenges. Let's start with relations with Europe and NATO. And being European myself, of course, I'm particularly interested and also sad about the relationship, the unfolding relationship with the continent of Europe. We shouldn't forget that US and European trade is still the most important trading relationship in the world. Well over 40% of all global trade is done between the United States and the European Union. It has only gone down slightly in the last few years. That is the most important trading relationship in the world. Much more important than the United States trade with China or the European trade with China. The transatlantic trade is really top notch. Therefore, that transatlantic trade and investment relationship is still being negotiated, but with chances are probably very poor now, is really a step in the right direction. It doesn't mean the deal which so far has been sort of semi-negotiated is ideal or perfect. It could be improved upon, definitely. But to have such a deal, to bring the Europeans and the United States and their companies closer together and to harmonize economic relationships and economic norms via that relationship is not a bad idea. And that should probably fail, I think, is not good for the West. What is the future of European integration? We all know the Eurozone, the European Union, is indeed crisis, the Euro crisis since really 2008, particularly it goes around Greece, where Greece is still a deeply troubled country, whether the solution, you know, austerity for Greece, or whether there should have been a generous, even more generous bailout, that's a matter of controversy, but definitely the Euro crisis is not over, it still lingers on, and we may still have some more surprises coming in the future. Italian banks are also probably need recapitalization. Italian banks are also loaded with debt, and there are other banks in other countries where the same problem continues. Then we have the refugee crisis, we all are familiar with that. Last year in Germany, almost 1 million refugees arrived. This year the number is down to 200,000, 250,000, not least due to a deal which was done between the German and the European government and Turkey, so that most of these refugees are now landed and stranded in Turkey in huge refugee camps and are not being able to continue to Europe. But the refugee crisis has, of course, led to a backlash in many European societies, in France, in Germany, in Austria, in many others, where nationalist, anti-foreigner, racist sentiments clearly have come into the open in a way which was unforeseen only a few years ago. So nationalism is not really dominant in the United States, but it clearly is a very important factor, has become a very important factor in European societies as well. And that refugee crisis and the sentiments connected to that, these nationalist sentiments which have come out because of it, I would say, that is continuing to talk as well. We have elections in the Netherlands soon, we have elections in France in April, May, we have elections in Germany in late September. And particularly the French elections, where right-wing leader Le Pen probably has a serious chance of becoming president, and then he would withdraw from the European Union, so that would be an utter disaster. It would really undermine not the stability, but the very existence of the European Union. Of course, we all hope it will not come to that, and there's also some reason to think that the European voters will have more common sense, will be more sensible than just go for nationalism, but it can't be excluded either. There are new right-wing-led governments in within the United within the European Union, particularly the government of Hungary and Poland, are clearly moving ever more into an autocratic direction that is a threat to democracy, a threat to European stability, and that needs to be watched. Then Germany seems to be, or Angela Merkel seems to be, the last man standing, so to speak. She has a relatively united country still behind her, and I would say that is because of the past. The Germans still remember the Nazi past, the Holocaust, and all what came from it much more vividly than other countries in Europe do. And while there has been a growth of a right-wing movement, the party, the AfD, I don't think it will get over 15, maximum 20% of the national vote in the election in September. That, of course, is also way too much, but it doesn't stand a chance of actually coming into the government or doing, you know, becoming responsible for national policies. That is most unlikely. Unlike in France, for example. And so it is really Merkel people look to for the stability of Europe at the moment. And, you know, one should not really depend on one country to keep the European Union together. That is not a good position to be in. And then, of course, and then Trump, to come back to Trump, Trump is not in favor of European integration. He thinks it's a disaster. He has undermined Angela Merkel by saying he really is, Germany is a vehicle, or the EU is a vehicle for Berlin, meaning that the Germans are exploiting the European Union, that they want to impose their leadership on the European Union, and the other places they have to be dragged along. That is actually not the case, and there's a lot of suspicion about German leadership still in Europe. Therefore, German politicians are always very careful not to be seen as being too leader, too full of leadership, too full of power in Europe. When we have, for example, the Minsk II agreement about Ukraine, Angela Merkel made sure that she took the French president along. Not that along was really needed, but it looked much better when it wasn't just the Germans, but also the French who went to negotiate that deal. And then we have Brexit, of course, and Brexit is problematic. It has undermined the EU clearly. In my belief, it has also undermined the strength of Britain. But of course, here opinions differ. But Trump today came out clearly once again in favor of Brexit, and he believes in a new US-UK relationship. As does Theresa May. And Theresa May, of course, has no other option. She is leaving the EU, and it will be a hard Brexit. So the only other powerful players you can go to is the United States. But for the United States, the UK is rather a minor player. You wouldn't have guessed it from the press conference today. But when you look at the Twitter, the tweets Trump set out today, there was lots about Mexico, there was lots about Portugal, there was lots about you know, other things which were on his mind. The UK wasn't mentioned at all, not in a single tweet. That indicates, of course, that for him the UK is not particularly important. What about NATO? Trump has come out repeatedly saying he thinks NATO is obsolete and wasn't necessary. His defense secretary, who got confirmed today, I think, he has supported NATO. And in the press conference he made today, Trump, Theresa May said that Trump assured her that he was 100% behind NATO, and he nodded when she said that. So it's totally contradictory, we don't know. But I would say, if the Europeans contribute more of their money to their membership dues for NATO, so to speak, if they get to the 2% contribution of each country's GDP as the membership dues to NATO, then I think the United States under Trump will probably be reassured. So personally, I do not think that the United States will withdraw from NATO or will further undermine it. Because also the Trump administration, particularly this man here, the new Secretary of Defense, and also probably Tillerson, will realize how important NATO is for the United States. The but NATO is the only institution in Europe where the United States is actually a member. And not just a member, they are heading it. Otherwise, there's no formal connection between the United States and Europe, apart from formally in NATO. And when you think about the strength of the United States in the world, these strengths are European strengths. If you take the EU and its members and NATO and its members away, who's left? But there are some smaller countries, but, you know, not also Australia and New Zealand, but in global terms, it is really the NATO members and the EU members who are the friends of the United States. And I'm hopeful that after a little while and a little bit of bargaining and negotiating, also the Trump administration will realize that. Oh, that brings us to Putin. Putin, as you can see, is a bit of a macho. And today it was announced that Trump will have an interesting conversation, a telephone conversation with Putin tomorrow. And he will also talk to Angela Merkel and French President Hollande tomorrow. But there was talk that Trump may suggest to Putin to lift the sanctions which were imposed on Russia because of the annexation of Crimea and the invasion of the semi invasion, I would say, of Eastern Ukraine. I mean, it's a very complicated relationship, Russia and the West. In a few words, I just would like to say, ever since Putin came to power as the successor of Boris Yeltsin in 1999-2000, he has had a chip on his shoulder about Russia's lack of influence in the world. And he has viewed it very, very critically that NATO enlarged in 1999, in 2004, and in 2009, and incorporated former states of the Soviet Union and former satellite states of the Soviet Union, like Poland, Hungary, the Baltic states, the former Czechoslovakia, and many other states, Albania recently. And he has never forgiven the West for that. He feels threatened. And to some extent, I think we can take him by his word. That he believes the West has broken its word, which is not really, that's never been proven that the West didn't promise to enlarge NATO. But Putin believes Gorbachev was promised by the United States NATO would not enlarge to the borders of Russia. He says that promise has been broken, we feel threatened, and our sphere of influence has really been encroached upon. Ever since, he has had a chip on his shoulder and wants to really do the opposite. He wants to expand the Russian sphere of influence. That led to the war with Georgia in 2008, when there was talk that Georgia and Ukraine may join NATO, for example. And of course, in March 2014, when there was the danger of Ukraine, from this point of view, was getting too close to the European Union and passing the future even to NATO, he annexed Crimea, ethnically Russia, and the important Russian port of Sebastopol, with the Black Sea fleet is there. So they thought we have to take that over. We can't afford the West, you know, having that port. And he invaded, semi-invaded, hybrid warfare, they call that, Eastern Ukraine. And as a reaction, of course, the West imposed ever more serious sanctions. Then in Syria, then in September 2015, he got involved in the Syria war. Here, also mistakes by the West were made. A vacuum shouldn't have been created, perhaps, which allowed Russia to go in. But Russia went not just in, but it went in a very brutal, cruel way, with lots of human rights violations, which cannot be simply overlooked. And then, of course, recently, we had all the hacking and fake news coming out of Russia, and also, apparently, though, of course, the Trump camp disputed Russia, was involved in the American election campaign of one way or the other. Should we re-engage with Putin? Yes, we should, of course. It doesn't make sense to have a pariah state who you hardly talk to be totally isolated. That never in world history has led to anything. We should re-engage. And maybe a Trump-Putin summit wouldn't be a bad idea. But it depends very much on the price we are prepared to pay. I think lifting sanctions for free without any counter-action from Putin would be pretty stupid. If Putin says, we implement the Minsk II agreement on Ukraine totally, keep out of Eastern Ukraine, that would be something, or also some progress in Syria. You know, some price has to be achieved if sanctions need to be lifted. And I think what we see with the Trump administration is that it probably will ignore Ukraine and Crimea, that the price will be cooperation against ISIS in Syria. In my view, I think that is not enough. But I fear that that may go, so that Putin gets quite an easy deal for lifting sanctions. Here we have a nice map. And here, of course, that is Crimea. And let me tell you. But Putin is, of course, not all anti-West. Putin also has a pro-Western taste. And maybe therefore, talks will be promising. Pro-Israel, pro-Netanyahu new ambassador. He American embassy is supposed to be shifted to Jerusalem, and the two-state solution is supposed to be given up. That, in my view, is bad. While the United States, the best hope for some sort of peace in that area seems to be still the two-state solution, Palestine, Israel. And the United States should not take sides, clearly. It should still try to continue to be the arbiter, to be a neutral arbiter, a mediator, as far as that is possible, between the two sides, rather than side clearly with one side, and then the other, of course, will feel very aggrieved. Of course, people are different about that. They differ on their views about that. But most analysts of the Middle East fear or believe that two-state solution is the only solution which has some possibility of some sort of success. I'm not an expert in Israel. We may smell things very, very differently. But the way it is going with the Trump administration seems to be clearly siding with Netanyahu and not with everyone else there. And Netanyahu himself is, of course, under corruption, speaking. So his position himself in Israeli politics is not all that strong. We haven't heard too much about Syria and ISIS cooperation with Russia. That probably is on the cards tomorrow in the phone conversation. I'm sure that will be talked about, but we don't know anything more precisely. But we do, what we have heard when Trump talked to the CIA, and he mentioned Iraq and said he was really against the war against Iraq, but on the other hand, you know, we should have taken the oil and maybe the CIA would get another chance of doing so, which was very reassuring, of course. Afghanistan, Saudi Arabia, we don't know what American policy will be in the future. That leaves China. And in my view, relations with China are actually the most dangerous or promised to be particularly dangerous in the future. Here, the Trump administration is particularly outspoken and, in my view, unnecessarily so. There are some serious problems with China. It's not that Trump never had a point. And the Obama administration also was very critical of China to some extent, not in all extent. But the Obama administration approach was a negotiated approach to try to talk about things. And that seems to have largely been given up now when we at least believe the campaign promises and also the statements since the inauguration. But of course, nothing much so far has happened. We may all be positively surprised, and maybe a more constructive policy will be embarked upon, but we don't know. What Trump has been saying all along is currency manipulation, that the Chinese are manipulating their currency. This, at the moment, is not true. That was true probably 10 years ago, maybe even up to 5 years ago, not at the moment. The Chinese currency is actually plummeting on the market, and the Chinese state is trying to bolster it, to push it. So they don't want to see their currency disappear, kind of bottomless pit. A little bit of a downward trend of the curve of the Chinese currency, the yuan, is acceptable, but not too much. And so the Trump's accusation that the Chinese government is manipulating its currency to make it weaker is totally untrue and has nothing to do with reality. That really is the disappearance of reality. All experts in the field, much greater economic experts than I am, they all are united in the belief that at the moment China is not manipulating its currency, not making it weaker. Unfair trade practices, that is a different matter. And here Trump has a point. As said the Obama administration before, as have many European governments who also are complaining about unfair trade practices. The text word here is reciprocity, that there is, and I will really keep that short, because it's quite a complex story, but essentially the Chinese state, Chinese companies, have pretty wide market access in the West. The same wide, generous market access to China by Western companies is not available. It's much more restricted. That is, of course, unfair and isn't helpful at all. And here, lots of things need to be done and ought to be done. The TPP, which Trump just undid and decided to scrap and not to go ahead with, that is rather self-defeating. While that partnership, that trade deal as such, again, probably wasn't the most perfect one, it could have been renegotiated, could have been improved upon, to scrap it, meaning you basically leave the 11 other nations which wanted to trade with the United States, all Asian states, you leave them to China. Because China has already suggested a free trade deal with exactly these nations. And where are these nations now going to go if the United States ends the TPP? They, of course, want to trade. They can't trade with a huge market which is the United States. They will go and trade with a huge market which is China. So it is a totally self-defeating move, which also doesn't endear the United States in a political sense to the neighbors of China, like Vietnam, like Thailand, like Taiwan, and Japan, importantly. So that is a most stupid move, I would say. And I don't understand why that would have been done apart from for ideological reasons and the causes have been attacked during the election campaign. Taiwan, again, I would say, is a very self-defeating policy. Taiwan is a core interest of China, and the one China policy is really what gets China up. That's nationalism, times 10. That is what the Chinese believe in, that China, Taiwan, is part of the Chinese homeland. And if you attack that policy, you immediately are at loggerheads with the Chinese. Now, after all, that policy has been pursued by all American governments since the late 1970s, essentially since the early 1970s. And now to undo that, to attack that, as Trump has done in his phone conversation with the Taiwanese president, does not make sense. You know, maybe at a later stage, when things have gone really bad, perhaps, but to start a relationship with that attack on a core interest doesn't really make sense. Then another area of controversy is, of course, the South China Sea. And here, both the Trump administration and the Obama administration have a point. The Chinese have been militarizing the islands and rocks and uninhabited islands in the South China Sea for quite a few years. And they want to maintain control over this area, and the United States wants to maintain maritime and defense access to that area. For example, here's a good example. That was a little island in 2006 that has been totally militarized and built up into a military base. And that is what the West protests about, and I think rightly. That is the area we are talking about, these tiny rocks and islands here. And just another example that I was sitting through. The militarization of that area, in 1999 we had that. Here on the left thing is the Chinese military that was the situation in 2016. That is the one projected in 2020. That is not good. And here something needs to be done. But of course it needs to be done in a negotiated war. You don't want to go to war over these rocks and islands in the South China Sea. Since 2011, we have a strategic dialogue between China and the United States. And I very much hope that the Trump administration will also continue that strategic dialogue. And then we still have the North Korea question, which we have no time to talk about now. You know, I will give a talk in March and I will come back to that. In conclusion, what advice can we give to the new president? Very briefly, global image, improve it. Urgently, Europe, NATO, be nice to the Europeans. Support European integration, support NATO, because these are your only friends, real friends in the world. Russia, yes, re-engagement with Putin, definitely, but at a decent price. Don't make it too easy. Don't give him the lifting of sanctions for nothing in return.
Middle East, rethink the policy towards Israel and Iran, I would suggest. China, yes, take them on, but in a negotiated way. Try to talk to them and not be too pushy and not attacking their core interests. And we haven't even talked about the issue of climate change, of nuclear weapons, and of course, that's the policy towards Mexico. So the Trump administration has a lot on its plate, and I hope he will do better than he has done so far. Thank you.